Welcome back. You know, the accuracy of many rifles can be greatly enhanced by a process that's generally known as free-floating and glass bedding. In this video, I want to discuss with you exactly what it is, what it seeks to accomplish, and we'll actually glass bed this rifle right here, this Tikka 222 Remington. Exactly what is glass bedding and free floating? Well, very simply, glass bedding and free floating doesn't really make the rifle accurate. It prevents inaccuracy. That might sound a little bit weird. The accuracy of the rifle is built into the barrel and into the loads that you produce or feed into it. What glass bedding and free floating does is prevents instability of the barrel in the stock, which contributes to inaccuracy, sometimes gross inaccuracy because of that instability. In a fine, accurate rifle, it's imperative that the barrel be allowed to vibrate, and there are vibrations and oscillations that strike and collide with the stock, and in so doing, it upsets the muzzle before the bullet actually exits. Stock and barrel relationship changes from one shot to another because the receiver is not situated in the stock firmly so that it's held snugly. There can't be, in other words, any rattling around of the receiver within the stock. And not only is it bad for accuracy, but it actually can contribute to eventual splitting of the stock if it's a gross looseness, because eventually that hammering within the stock can actually start taking it apart like a jackhammer. But when you glass bed and free float a stock, you're really not creating accuracy that would be otherwise inherent in the gun. You can't make an inaccurate gun accurate by simply free-floating and glass bedding it. However, a great majority of rifles, especially rifles that are brand new out of the box, can be enhanced tremendously by the simple process of glass bedding and free-floating. And they go hand in glove. Many rifles these days come from the factory, as they have been for generations, where, as I showed in a previous video about the accurate rifle, where the fore end of the stock, this portion up here, there's a high pillar of wood which sits directly underneath the barrel and cradles the barrel. And the reason for that, many people are puzzled, why would a manufacturer not just simply free float the barrel all the way down and be done with it? Why have that upsetting pillar? Well, actually, that pillar has been put in there to create stability, because it's relatively expensive manpower-wise to glass bed or intimately fit a stock to its action. The machinery that's used to carve out wood from a wood stock they're on replication lathes. And they can't possibly, you're dealing with an organism which is wood. It's not machined metal. There are just so many tolerances that can be adhered to before the stock might split if it were too tightly engaged around the receiver. So the alternative for a manufacturer is to, which has been the custom for many years, is to simply bed the barrel at the fore end of the stock, and by screwing down the receiver, it basically holds it rigidly through about a 20 inch or so span. And that does a pretty good job of settling down vibration. There is no collision with the stock, because the stock actually rides with the barrel, or vice versa. It tends to dampen the vibration, which in some rifles actually can contribute to. Some rifles shoot very, very nicely with a heavily bedded barrel. I've seen this myself. I even had a Ruger Model 77 22-250 many years ago. It was a 1976 bicentennial model that shot quarter-inch groups quite regularly, and that had a firm, it was a varmint model, and it had a firmly bedded barrel. So it's possible, it's quite possible, to have a very, very accurate rifle with a firmly bedded factory-stocked rifle. Now, having said that, it's generally easier to accomplish high grade of accuracy by allowing the barrel to free float, in other words, for its harmonics to take place without any influence by the stock whatsoever, without colliding with the stock during the firing, without dampening or anything else. In other words, the barrel is just operating on its own. But one cannot simply, and I can speak from experience, one simply cannot achieve accuracy by free-floating the stock. Free-floating the stock alone will very, very frequently lead to some of the worst accuracy problems that you could possibly run into, simply because the gun starts reacting just as the manufacturer knew that it would, without that cushion up front, without that stabilizing fore-end pillow. So, in order to stabilize the action, it's necessary to do both. You just don't hog out wood, generally, and not stabilize the action. Now, this particular rifle right here, this is a Tikka. It's a Tikka T3 Hunter, wood stocked. Matter of fact, I got very fortunate on this one. This stock right here would be worthy of being on a Winchester Super Grade Model 70. There's no question about it. Look at that tiger stripe, the burl. That's a beautiful hunk of walnut that you don't generally see on a bargain Seiko. That's what a Tikka is. It's a bargain Seiko. They're all made with the same long action, so they can cut down on cost by not having all the multitude of different actions and stock inletting that they have to have with their flagship line. This particular rifle right here is a classic example of a 222 from the box that shoots superlative groups. This is a free-floated barrel. You can see, look very closely, you can see there's, see if I can get the light to shine in there. There's plenty of flex. You can see there's at least 3/16 of an inch of flex, so there's no collision whatsoever, especially with this mild cartridge. This is a 222, is the original case that begat the 222 Remington Magnum, and then later the 221 Fireball, and of course the 223, the great 223 5.56 NATO. But this stock has never been glass bedded. It's free floated from the factory. What a nice job they did. So this is what a hand load did. My first hand loads for this particular rifle. I took some Hodgdon H322 powder, which is renowned for its accuracy in this particular cartridge. And you can see right here, these were the first three shots. This is from a cold, clean bore, brand new rifle. One, two, three, and then I adjusted the scope to bring it down 1 inch, and then I fired this particular group. Oops, right here. I fired this particular group right here, three shots into this hole. This is 100 yards, and I had to measure it twice because I couldn't believe my micrometer measuring edge to edge, the outer edges. It measures 0.174. That's unbelievable. Brand new rifle. So much for breaking in a barrel. And here is 0.2. Now, each one of these groups represents 0.2 of a grain upward increase. In other words, I was doing an incremental test series with this rifle. So, in other words, this group here is fired with the first increment. Then I graduated to this increment here, which was 0.2 of a grain more. 0.2 being in proportion to the size of the case. Basically, it's a 20-odd, it's a 20-grain capacity case thereabouts, roughly. So this brings it up 2/10. This brings it up another 2/10. And then I went to this group down here, brings it up another 2/10. And finally, this brings it up another 2/10. Then finally, what I did was I fired I like to always fire a composite group. I had one shot remaining from each of those test lots, and I fired it into one group right here. And you can see that measures 0.60. So in other words, 0.6 inch composite group over a span of one full grain. In other words, so for those of you who, you know, I've spoken about this before. For those of you who think that it's necessary to weigh every single charge, and if you're using extruded powders, because H322 is a very short grained extruded powder, but that's a classic example of why it's foolish to try to weigh out every single charge. By the way, these were all dumped with a measure. Once I got the first one adjusted 0.2 grain up, I set the measure and just dumped the next three. That's all I did. I actually dumped all four that way. So every one of those is a dumped measure. So you might be wondering, and I'm actually kind of wondering myself, why should I glass bed this rifle if it's shooting like that? Well, it's just me, I guess. I've always enjoyed tinkering with guns, and it's been my experience that if a gun shoots, whatever a gun shoots before it's been glass bedded, it'll shoot just a little bit better, sometimes much better, if it's been glass bedded. So let's take you on a journey through this particular gun first of all, and I'll show you what we're dealing with. The Tikka is a little bit different than some of the other guns on the market, but I'll show you exactly what it is we're dealing with, and we'll go right into glass bedding it. Okay, so I've removed the scope so that we can work on the gun. And as you can see now with the stock removed, rather than being the typical recoil lug, which is integral to the receiver or sandwich between the barrel and the receiver, they use a metal key, and that fits into a shallow keyway in the front of the receiver. Remember, this is a rifle which is designed for the utmost in accuracy while maintaining low cost for production, so that we can enjoy accuracy without spending a fortune. So this keyway here, and this key engages right here. This key slot in the stock, which looks very familiar and very similar to if you looked at this stock without the barrel and receiver set up, you'd just assume that that was a typical stock and receiver relationship. But as you can see, it's that unique little difference right there. And on first blush, you'd say, well, gee, that doesn't look very strong. And I've seen a lot of remarks online about how inefficient and how inaccurate that is. Well, I think I put that to rest by showing you that target. This shallow keyway is proven. It's able to withstand more than sufficient recoil. This is not standing by itself. Remember, this is firmly bedded into hard wood, into hard walnut. This is very dense walnut, by the way. This is extremely dense. You can't press your fingernail into that and leave a mark. It's extremely dense, almost steel, like wood. Very tough grain. There's also, too, if you notice, there's some raised surfaces right here. There's some bolsters that are raised up. They're approximately, I would say they're about maybe 3/64 inch high. There's a bolster here on this end, and there's a bolster here on this end, which is a raised surface. That's really a nice piece of detailing right there, because that right there is what gives this receiver lateral stability in the stock, because those bolsters mate right here with these recesses. You can see as they line up, the screw holes line up, and there's recesses for those bolsters right here. So those are centering devices, which also act as miniature recoil lugs. But we can certainly assume that, you know, wood being what it is, that it cannot possibly be fully mated to the stock in the same way that it would be mated if it were glass bedded. The glass bedding will fill in any gaps, the most microscopically small gaps, that will fill them in and make for a very, very intimate combination. And now, at the same time, we will be bedding this key, this recoil block, that will be bedded permanently into the stock. And by bedding that permanently into the stock, at the same time that it is bedded with the receiver, that will mean that this relationship will always be square. Any potential for lack of squareness between those two surfaces will be filled in by the glass bedding material. And when we say glass bedding material, we're not necessarily talking about fiberglass or anything like that. That's a generic term which has come around from many years ago. Acroglass was one of the companies, Brownell's Acroglass is one of the companies that is out there that makes a product which has a glass flock that's mixed in with the compound, which gives it, you know, it's a mechanical additive, which is basically ground fiberglass, which adds to the consistency. But there are many different formulations on the market. What I'm going to do is use a Devcon product, which is more commonly used now by many gunsmiths. It's harder, and I'm going to use a little bit different release agent. So let's show you all those different products before we begin any further. This Devcon product is what I'm going to be using. Now, through the years, I've done quite a number of guns with both Acroglass and with Devcon two-part epoxy that you buy in a hardware store. Not the five-minute epoxy, please. That stuff there will set up so fast, and it's weaker. It doesn't have the structural stability over the years. But I've used two-part epoxy that comes in squeeze tubes, and it works out very, very nicely. Now there's a gel, which is even more stable to work with, and I've used that. But there is a certain shrinkage factor that goes along with that stuff if you're using more than, say, a quarter of an inch in any given location, which sometimes is what happens with glass bedding. You arrive in places where you have more buildup than a quarter of an inch, and you don't want to have any shrinkage that would reduce the tightness of stability. This right here is product number 10110. This is plastic steel putty A. There is a plastic steel liquid, which is B. That's not what you want. That's a runny substance that pours out like molasses, and it's be impossible to work with for glass bedding. This is a plastic steel putty. This is the first time that I will actually use this product myself, so we're going to be working with it together. And if you explore the contents, this is, by the way, this is not for children. This is there's warnings all over this stuff. It's for industrial use only. It's quite expensive. This is not a commercial packaging. You have to get this from industrial sources. But this is used in industry for very heavy duty applications for machinery repair and things like that. This is a plastic steel. They also have plastic stainless steel. They have plastic, you name it. I think they even have a plastic titanium, which is much, much more expensive. But it's a two-part deal with this. It's almost as if there's nothing in this. This feels so light. I haven't opened it yet. It's a sealed container. This is so light you almost think that you got gypped, that there's nothing in this container. It feels as if it's empty. this is the product and this is the hardener. So we'll be mixing that according to directions, and even though this is expensive, I paid almost $50 for these products. This will do, you know, if I'm economical in my mixing, I can certainly do quite a number of projects with this compound. So that's that. So the other things that you're going to need naturally are good fitting screwdriver for your gun. You want to have handy all your parts. Make sure you have everything lined up on your bench so that you can get at it right away. You may possibly need to free float your fore end. If you do, I recommend that you get a 60 or perhaps an 80 grit paper and a hard mandrel. This here happens to be an old 22 sawed off barrel I use for a mandrel, but you can roll that, a sheet of that around, and this 60 grit will cut that wood very, very swiftly. Use extreme caution with 60 grit paper. This is for heavy stock removal. Try it a little at a time until you reach the desired free floating, and be very careful that you don't over sand and that you don't sand unevenly. Follow up with progressively finer grits of paper until you get down to at least 150 grit. Then follow up that with an application of some stock preservative, finishing preservative. I prefer a Formby's that you can get in the any paint department. Formby apostrophe S. Plumber's putty. You want to have plumber's putty because you're going to be filling holes and recesses that would attract and basically become seizure points for the epoxy. You don't want to have the dread situation where epoxy has seeped into holes and becomes a hook and hangs on to your receiver. You can have a real problem if you can't get that stock loose. You'll need some electrical tape, vinyl electrical tape with some good stretch to it. That's important. And Kiwi neutral shoe polish. You want neutral. You don't want any color in it because you don't want to be coloring. You don't want to be colorizing your project. You want to make sure that you have neutral. And you can, by the way, I've used butcher's wax. You know, it comes in a big can, but this is far more economical, and this is enough in here probably for 200 guns. It does a nice job. Have yourself a parts brush for applying, a clean parts brush for applying the Kiwi. And I think we should be about ready to begin. But before we do, I want to show you what we're actually trying to accomplish. It's always good, you know, just like when you go to the bookstore and you pick out a recipe book for cooking, it's always nice to see what the dish is supposed to look like when you're done. So we're going to take apart a gun which has got beautiful glass bedding, which was accomplished by Winchester on this fine model 70, and let me get this gun apart and we'll show you what a good batch of glass bedding looks like. Now this is an exemplary piece of work right here. This shows the finest type of glass bedding that I've ever seen done commercially, and this is very, very, very functional. This is my 257 Roberts that shoots tack hole groups all the time, and you can see it's a very conservatively bedded system. It's just bedding the recoil lug. There's a little bit of bedding around the screw, and I'm going to describe something here in a minute. And in the back, the tang, the square abutment, there is a bolster that fits right down into that epoxy. It looks as if this is perhaps also Devcon, this industrial epoxy that we'll be using very shortly, but you can see it's inletted. It's inletted right underneath this tang very nicely. It doesn't exceed the bounds of the tang. In other words, it covers it up and hides the process once it's done. Also notice that the tang itself will bear onto wood. When the action is set down into the stock, it always needs to have a place to call home. You can never simply hog out wood and expect your glass to fill in all the mistakes, because what's going to happen is your action is just going to sink out of sight and you're going to have one very serious mess, a ruined gun basically. You need to maintain the original factory inletting for stability. What you're going to be doing is relieving certain areas. In other words, maintaining, here is my base right here. I'll be maintaining a base on our project, and that's the height that the receiver must sit in the stock. But we'll be relieving areas around here, which will permit that glass to fit and form around it. And also too, up here, you notice that the barrel itself is given a little bit of support, only out about 3/8 of an inch or so. That's all that's necessary. Now with certain rifles, if you have a Ruger model 77 that has the angled four screw, you absolutely have to bed at least an inch and a half or so out in front of that, in front of the receiver, because otherwise the barrel will tend to tilt forward. You'll have stresses that will be pulling down on that barrel. So be sure, if you're using glass bedding on a Ruger Model 77 with the angled four screw, that has got to be bedded out a little bit farther so that you can maintain that support. And that means literally holding the barrel stable. If you have a rifle which is not yet free floated, don't do your free floating until you've completed your glass bedding, because that will make sure that you maintain the correct barrel height. Otherwise you'll have the same situation. Your barrel will sink down. It may sink down too deeply, and then you'll be hogging out an awful lot more wood than you need to, and it can create an unsightly mess. You want to maintain the parallelism as it was from the factory. So if your gun still has that pillow that the barrel rests on, leave it there, and that will maintain a stable platform for your rifle for your glass bedding project. Once you get the glass bedding completed, then you can free float the barrel. Free floating meaning along the underside, removing that support pillow, and also free floating along the edges. How much? I prefer to go about 1/16 of an inch. Some people consider that to be too much, but in my experience, especially heavier recoiling calibers like 308s and 30-06s, you can very easily have barrel slapping of that stock, which you don't want, and that's what causes those flyers that every now and then creep outside your group. So even though it's not as nice in appearance, this rifle has got about 1/16 of an inch clearance, and my Tikka has got about 1/16 of an inch clearance, which is what you'd like to maintain if you have a rifle that has not yet been free floated. So what we're going to do is try to replicate that. Now, why only these two points? Because so many times, you know, you'll see the whole stock glass bedded. This is why. If you have two-point contact, it's absolutely stable. And this is the whole reason behind having just point-to-point contact rather than having it contact all the way from one end to the other. By having just point contact at the front screw and the rear screw, you have absolutely rock solid stability. If you have glass which flows in between, then what you have is a potential for rocking. If the wood should, and you have to expect that with a wood stock, that the wood can, this is a natural grain, And you can expect that perhaps if in differences in humidity and temperature, this grain can curl. Maybe imperceptibly to you and me, but it can curl enough to put a little bit of a stress on the receiver where it beds in the middle. And especially with longer receivers, such as the this one here happens to be a long receiver, and the Tikka is a long receiver. So anytime you have long receivers like that, there's the potential for more stress between the two screws should anything curl in between. So that's why I prefer, and obviously Winchester followed that same doctrine in bedding only from point to point. In other words, just the two screws. That's all that's necessary. Remember, we're not seeking. There's no point in making the entire wood and all this wood and metal become one. That's not what we're seeking to do. What we're seeking to do is stabilize the action, and by stabilizing the action at each screw point, that is all we need to do. In other words, it's grabbing hold here and it's grabbing hold here, and just like you hold the rifle. In other words, from your fore end to your shoulder. And I mentioned one other thing about, I wanted to mention a peculiarity about these screw holes that's worth noting. If you check this screw hole back here, the tang screw, when the tang screw is fitted into it, there is clearance. There's clearance around that hole, which is approximately a 32nd of an inch all around, so that there's no binding. However, with the front screw, there's actually this is actually bedded with the. It's actually threaded right there because the glass bedding was allowed to flow down inside that screw, just as it was here. But in this case, they reamed it out afterwards. After the epoxy was set, this was reamed out to provide clearance. And in this situation, in the front, it was maintained tight. And that is actually an enhancement to accuracy, because this screw then becomes a secondary support for your recoil lug, and it's close enough to the recoil lug to have no stress built up between the two. If there's tightness on this tang screw here, I have seen many times, I've done my own testing where I've not reamed out this hole, and I've had shots all over the place, but then after I reamed out this hole, the gun quieted down. There tends to be torque buildup between these two screws. So make sure you have. You can also relieve this screw hole, but I think it's better. My experience has been that it's better to do as Winchester does here, by maintaining that contact with the screw to the wood. It gives it a little bit of extra stability, especially with heavy recoiling guns. It gives you a recoil surface, and it won't bang into it. And years ago I had a rifle where I actually had the screw bang into this section of wood right here, and it drove out a section of wood here that I had to replace with glass. I had to rebuild it. So you don't want to have this banging into it. Whatever you do, either make it snug, perfectly snug like that, where there's actually perfect contact, I'm actually threading into it, or have it completely relieved, but don't have it intimately close where it can possibly bang into it and create a split in your stock. So let's proceed. Before we proceed to the next video, good conscience dictates to me that I really need to warn you. This is not easy work. This is not something for a rank beginner who's never worked with their hands before. If you're a person who tends to get frustrated when things get scary, if you panic easily, if you're the type of person who couldn't finish a model airplane when you were a kid or something like that because you got frustrated with all the parts and the glue, and if you're a person who tends to make a mess with things when you're doing things that are work, you're going to be working with some pretty high-grade epoxy here that makes a real mess in a hurry if you're not able to control it. This is a little bit like when, you know, 8 tons of concrete are dumped into your backyard and you didn't line up the help ahead of time, and you're standing there with one shovel trying to figure out how to spread that stuff around. This stuff goes very, very fast. Sometimes you're, even though the can says it has 45 minute working time, my experience has been you better be pretty well done in 10 or 12 minutes, otherwise things can start getting pretty scary for you. And you've got to be detail oriented enough to be able to follow instructions to the letter, because everything that we do in this next video will be very comprehensive, very detail oriented, and some of the things are there to provide protection against some things that can be really bad for your gun. So you know who you are. You know that if you're mechanically inclined, if you like to work with your hands, you don't mind getting dirty, and you don't frighten easily when you know, things get a little bit scary, then this is for you. But otherwise, if you're the person who is timid about doing this sort of thing, please don't take it upon yourself to start working on your fine, trusty new gun, because this is no time to do that. Give the work to a professional who can do it for you. So we'll see you in the next video. Don't forget to subscribe, and God bless.